Hi, this is Dr. Bain. This is a brief piece about personality development and communication. Most of the information from this unit comes from the International Encyclopedia of Communication, edited by Wolfgang Donsbach. And this particular article is by James B. Weaver. Just to let you know, this presentation is not meant to substitute for reading the unit and the articles that are provided online, but hopefully it will help make those more clear. All right. Gordon Allport was the first to demonstrate the link between communicative perceptions and behaviors in 1937. He identified about 18,000 words that described common personality dispositions or traits, and about a quarter of these eventually, after they were categorized, described some aspect of communication. Some of those characteristics were things like shyness and friendliness, clearly elements that are related to communication. Okay, so out of that, he was able to start the foundation for defining personality. Which the definition we go by today is a dynamic and organized set of characteristics or personality dimensions, which each uniquely influence a person's thoughts, motivations, behaviors. Our personality develops through the interaction between genetic history, so not just our parents, but the entire genetic history, and a variety of physical, social, and cultural factors over time. Generally, personality shows stability and continuity over our entire lifespan. So you can see there in the fourth bullet down that begins with the word develop, what we often know as nature and nurture. They both play a role in the development of our personality. How much? Well, based on research collectively right now, the estimate is that about 40% of our personality comes from our genetic makeup, and the rest of it comes from social, physical, and cultural environmental factors. Those environmental and nurture factors, physical, social, cultural, environmental, play a very strong role early in our childhood, until somewhere between the ages of 6 and 11, our personality becomes fairly stable and the bulk of it is formed. Then, as you might remember, during adolescence, that personality becomes malleable again, but it's not nearly as flexible and able to be shaped as it is during those early years. So we don't really see radical changes, but we do see a few changes and some reshaping at that point. Over time, researchers were able to identify dimensions of our personalities, and unfortunately, we don't have a great deal of agreement about personality dimensions in terms of numbers. Isink is the researcher that many communication scholars use when they do personality-related research. And he identified, just made it very, very simple, three broad categories or dimensions, and they are extroversion, neuroticism, and psychoticism. Extroversion is seen or associated with traits such as sociability, social adaptability and activity, and a positive self-esteem. Somebody who's identified as more neurotic, you tend to see more anxiety, emotionality, and a negative self-image. Psychoticism is a dimension where you tend to see egocentricity, social autonomy and deviance, and impulsivity, sort of a callousness to others. The more research we get in communication, the more we can see that the Isink theory, this three-factor, three-dimension theory, provides an explanation and prediction of self-perceptions about communicating. So what we're seeing is this very simple theory, which is you know, simplicity is one of the characteristics of a really good theory, is helping to explain and predict a lot of what we're learning about communication. All right, a little bit more about extroversion. If you exhibit extroversion, you probably see yourself as confident, patient, probably a skilled communicator. People who exhibit extroversion tend to freely express sympathy. They tend to be perceptive and attentive to others. They endorse sort of a people-oriented approach that reflects patience and interest in others. Hence, extra, meaning outside of. People who exhibit neuroticism more than the other dimensions tend to be imperceptive. They tend to be defensive during social interactions. They lack patience and finesse when they communicate. They really ardently filter both verbal and nonverbal content. They become susceptible to information overload fairly easily, and the same is true for confusion. Something unique about those who exhibit the neuroticism dimension is that they have sort of a strange or unique social shyness. They seem at first acquiescent and demure, preferring sort of less contact with others, and yet at the same time, they report considerable hostility and frustration during the same interactions where they acted demure and sort of agreeable. And finally, the psychoticism dimension is characterized by behaviors about unsupportive, unresponsive, and verbally aggressive socially. They are not interested in a lot of social interactions, very uncomfortable for them. They seem to lack empathy and sympathy for others. They're inattentive and they don't listen well. They're very impatient in their listening. Frequently, people who exhibit psychoticism seek to control interpersonal interactions through rudeness or by infusing conversations with culturally avant-garde marginalized jargon. Stuff that would be interruptive. Now, I was saying earlier that a lot of communication research has found that the iSync theory, in its simplicity, does a nice job of explaining and predicting many communication behaviors and choices. Here's an example. In the study by Norton and Benders in 1996, who examined three styles. They had sort of developed three styles of communication, and they did a study to see what the relationship was between these styles and the three dimensions. And what they found was that they synced up very nicely. Extroverts tended to prefer or endorse the non-directive communication style. Neurotics preferred or endorsed the elusive style. And psychotics endorsed the directive style. And the article that we have provides more information about those styles. Okay, that's a nice introduction to personality and why it's important to acknowledge and have a little bit of investment in understanding personality when we study communication. Thanks.